TryAdaptLearn. In this video, we're going to try to give a brief introduction about electricity. If you haven't already subscribed, don't forget to subscribe now for more videos including DIY, maintenance, projects, and yard work. The goals of the video are to introduce some of the vocabulary associated with electricity. Getting familiar with this vocabulary will relate to some of the projects or equipment in the videos on this channel. Well, let's start by defining electricity. Electricity can be described as the movement of electrons between atoms. Electrons are subatomic particles. Since electrons are subatomic particles, let's begin with discussing the structure of atoms. In this container, you'll notice liquid water, which is also known as H2O. H2O is made up of one oxygen and two hydrogen atoms. It is a compound or type of molecule. In this view, the oxygen is represented by the white lid container and the two hydrogen atoms are represented by the black lid containers. Please keep in mind that unlike the representations in this video, atoms and subatomic particles are actually spherical in shape. So just as an atom is an individual, two or more atoms bonded together can create a molecule. Water, or H2O, is a compound or type of molecule. This is a visual aid to help communicate vocabulary about atoms, molecules, and compounds. When considering molecules or compounds, please keep in mind that these are atoms that have been bonded together at the atomic level and not just arranged near each other. With that in mind, let's focus on just the single atom. Atoms can be made of subatomic particles. These include electrons, protons, and neutrons. The nucleus is the area in the center of the atom that has the protons and neutrons. It is important to know that the number of protons in the atom is the atomic number on the periodic table of elements. It is also important to know that the proton has a positive charge. Outside of the nucleus, there are shells or layers of orbits containing electrons. These electrons are negatively charged. There are some electrons that can move from atom to atom. This movement is what we know as electricity. As a side note, most of the times atoms are balanced with the same amount of protons and electrons. If there are more protons than electrons, the atom will be positively charged. If there are more electrons than protons, the atom will be negatively charged. When atoms have a positive or negative charge, they can also be referred to as ions. And so now that we've talked about atoms, here are a few diagrams of some of the atoms we talked about. The first diagram here you can see is hydrogen. Hydrogen having one electron and one proton. As compared to hydrogen, the next diagram we have is the atom of oxygen. Now oxygen has 8 electrons, 8 protons, and 8 neutrons. And since we're really talking about electricity and not water, I thought it would be kind of fun to throw in a copper diagram. Copper has 29 electrons, 29 protons, and 35 neutrons. Just please keep in mind that although these diagrams are two-dimensional, these are actually representing three-dimensional objects. Again, the movement of electrons from atom to atom can be referred to when describing electricity or discussing electrical flow or electrical current. Now that we've discussed electricity or the flow of electrical current or electrons from atom to atom, let's discuss conductors and insulators. A conductor is a material such as copper wire that allows electrical current to flow or pass through. An insulator is a material that does not allow electric current to flow or allows very little electric current to flow. A multimeter is truly a multi-use test, measuring, or metering device. We can use the continuity test on this multimeter to help demonstrate a conductor versus an insulator. As you'll see, when the test leads are connected, this completes the circuit and the value is changed on the display to indicate continuity. When the materials can conduct electricity on the continuity test, the value changes as if the test leads were connected. This means that the material will allow electricity to pass through and act as if it was one continual conductor or wire. On insulators, the continuity test is the same as if the wires are not touching. When electricity can flow through a conductor, the route it takes is called a circuit. In this example, we will use a wire to demonstrate a closed circuit. When the ends of the wire are connected, the electricity would be able to flow through. When the ends of the wire are open, the electricity is then an open circuit and electricity will not flow through. In the video, we can use this wire to demonstrate the function of a switch to open and close the circuit. The function of the switch to open and close the circuit happens inside the casing. Because it would be inconvenient and very unsafe to connect and disconnect wires with an electrical current, we can use a switch like this toggle switch, which performs the same function. This copper wire covered with an insulator is what we normally see with electrical wiring. There are also different types of vocabulary associated with electrical wiring. In this view, we can see the difference between stranded and solid core wire. Solid or solid core wiring is associated with a single solid core piece of copper. Stranded wire may still be made of copper but includes multiple smaller wire strands rather than a single larger wire. Stranded wire is usually used where more frequent bending occurs or is anticipated. Solid wire may be considered higher quality, but it is used where little to no frequent bending occurs. Another thing to consider is the gauge or thickness of the wire. In this view, we can see different gauges or thicknesses of wire. When the wire is higher in the gauge number, the diameter or thickness is smaller. When the gauge number is lower, the diameter or thickness of the wire is larger. So a 14 gauge wire will be a thin wire, while a 4 gauge wire will be a thick wire. In a general sense, the thicker the wire, the more current or amperage can flow through. Some wire also has different thicknesses of insulation. So wire gauge cannot necessarily be determined by the outside diameter of the insulator on the wires. The gauge of the wire measures the actual electrical conductor wires and does not include the insulator. Sometimes too much current may flow through in a wire or a circuit. Fuses are electrical safety devices that can be made to break when too much current flows through. Once fuses break, the circuit will be open and the flow of electricity will be stopped. Fuses are a great safety device because once the electricity is stopped, it can possibly prevent more electrical damage. Fuses are also an immediate indication of an electrical issue to the operator and can allow for troubleshooting. With a multimeter, we can measure resistance, voltage, and current. Resistance is the measurement of restriction or resistance to the flow of the electrical current. In this view, we can measure resistance with the units of ohms. The multimeter can measure resistance in most electrical wires. It's important to understand that to properly measure resistance on a wire, you usually need some kind of a reference table that would indicate how many ohms at a specific length the reading should be. The multimeter can measure resistance in wires such as stranded wire, solid core wire, and even spark plug wires. You can also use a multimeter to measure resistance in spark plug wires. You can also use the multimeter to measure resistance in an ignition coil. In electronics, there are components called resistors. Resistors specifically are made to resist or restrict the flow of electricity. Using a multimeter, we can test the resistance of a resistor. Voltage is the difference in the electrical potential between two points in a circuit measured in volts. Voltage can also be described as potential difference, electromotive force, and electric pressure. You can also measure voltage with a multimeter. In this view, you can measure voltage in a standard 1.5 volt battery. You can also measure voltage in a 12 volt automotive battery. An electrical tester commonly used with simple or older 12 volt systems is called a 12 volt test light. These test lights include a bulb and are used to help detect voltage. The clip goes on the negative or ground, and anytime the lead touches a positive, the light will light up. As a side note, it's worth saying that a test light is a simple tool that should be used for simple tests on simple electrical systems. By that I mean to express caution when using 12-volt test lights on complex computer-controlled electrical systems in modern vehicles. Current is the amount of charge flowing in the circuit measured with amps. Multimeters can also be used to measure current. This test will measure the amount of current that the test light itself is drawing from the 12-volt battery. To do this, we will use the multimeter connected in series or in line with the 12-volt test light. As seen by the size of the wires connected to the multimeter, it's really only meant to measure small amounts of current and a maximum of 10 amps. In fact, some multimeters come with a separate test lead just to specifically measure loads of up to 10 amps. As a bonus, we can see some visual aids about Ohm's law. This vocabulary and some of the simple tests have been used on some of the older videos on this channel and will be used on future videos. We'll likely cover this in a future video, but for right now we have this up to introduce it and to establish that there is a relationship between current, resistance, voltage, and even power. Again, I hope this video introduced some of the vocabulary associated with electricity. As I make new videos, I want to share them with you, so subscribe now. Also, comment, like, and check out some of the other content on our channel.